Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Justice Committee's 22nd meeting of 2015. Could I remind all to either switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices or put them onto airport mode so they don't interfere with the sound system. I have received apologies from Christine Graham, which is why I'm sitting in her seat today. First item up is item one, a decision on taking business in private. The committee is invited to agree to consider our draft stage one report on the inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden deaths, etc. Scotland Bill under item seven, and any future consideration of the report if needed in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Excellent. Item two, subordinate legislation. Our next item is the consideration of one affirmative instrument, the draft advice and assistance by way of representation, Scotland Amendment number 3, Regulations 2015. So I welcome to the meeting Paul Wheelhouse, Minister for Community Safety and Legal Affairs, and the Scottish Government officials, Catriona MacKenzie, Civil Law and Legal System Division, and Alastair Smith, Directorate for Legal Services. This item allows us to gather evidence in advance of the debate on the instrument under the next item. Members will have seen the submission from the Law Society of Scotland confirming that they had no comment to make on this order. I understand that the Minister does not need an opening statement.
That's correct, Convener.
And I will therefore go straight to questions from members. Any questions on the instrument?
How was this problem detected, as it were?
Well, it's a good point. The provision for double jeopardy has only been really used. This is indeed only the third application to have been made to the High Court by Lord Advocate, and we were informed earlier this month that there is an individual currently the subject of double jeopardy application who does not qualify for ABWAR, but will not be able to afford the cost of his legal representation without it, and therefore, as a result of deliberations, we consider that public funding should be made available in order to secure the individual's right to effective access to justice in terms of Article 6 of ECHR, and hence, given the urgency of the case, why we are here today to move this order.
And in terms of the financial effects going forward, any further comment on that? Are we regarding it as a one-off, or do you think this could be a trend?
Well, as I say, just repeat the point, these proceedings are very rare. This is only the third such application. The change is expected to have relatively little significant impact on overall expenditure from the legal aid fund, but in the context of the nature of the case, it will be a significant case in its own right. And individual case costs are typically fairly high, and we've estimated in the region of £100,000 for this case. There are very few cases of this kind. As I say, these regulations will only add this kind of cost to the fund in cases where the person involved had not previously been financially eligible for ABWAR, and indeed, as we can't discuss the case itself, but the reason why this is necessary is that the individual concerned is as someone who's been acquitted of a crime and therefore under double jeopardy procedures is not technically yet accused of anything specifically. So it's an application for a double jeopardy procedure.
So in broad terms, you're not concerned with the ongoing financial impact?
Well, clearly we are, as Mr. Campbell will be aware, trying to manage legal aid budgets, and so I wouldn't want to say that we have no concerns about additional expense, but clearly we think this is a level of expenditure that can be borne within the legal aid budget, and we don't have any significant concerns on that front.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Okay, thank you. We can now move to the formal debate on the motion to approve the instrument considered under the previous item. I therefore invite the Minister to move motion S4M 13503 that the Justice Committee recommends that the draft advice and assistance by way of representation, Scotland Amendment number 3, Regulations 2015, be approved. Any members wish to speak on the motion? Everybody content?
Formally moved.
Oh, sorry. sorry. Okay, so the question is that motion S4M 13503 be adhered to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Excellent, thank you. Thank the Minister for his attendance today. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Did Yes, there's a subordinate legislation. Item four is subordinate legislation. Our next business is the consideration of one negative instrument. That's the All Scotland Sheriff Court, Sheriff Personal Injury Court Order 2015, SSI 2015/213. The instrument designates Edinburgh Sheriff Court as a Sheriff Personal Injury Court to exercise all Scotland jurisdiction in cases above £5,000 and jurisdiction in cases below £5,000 for specific cases designated by the Order. Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee is content with the drafting of the instrument. So do members have any comments on SSI 2015-213? Are members content to make no recommendation in relation to the instrument? Excellent. So, suspend briefly to allow Margaret and her officials to take up their seats as witnesses. Resume proceedings now with item five, the Apologies Scotland Bill. Our final evidence session on this piece of legislation. I welcome Margaret Mitchell, member in charge of the bill, to the meeting as a witness, along with the Scottish Parliament officials, Mary Dinsdale, Senior Assistant Clerk in the Non-Government Bills Unit, and Neil Ross, Solicitor with the Committee and Chamber team. And I understand that Margaret would like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, for giving me the opportunity to make a few brief opening remarks about the Apology Bill. One of the main purposes of the Bill is to address the apparently entrenched culture in Scotland, as one witness put it, to never apologise and don't say you're sorry for anything. It is not indeed, as some mistakenly thought, to tackle any perceived increase in litigation, but rather to address the very real problem of a reluctance and failure to offer an apology for fear of litigation. The bill therefore seeks to provide legal certainty that an apology cannot be used as evidence of liability in certain legal proceedings. I first became aware of the existence of apology legislation when Professor Miller, the Scottish Human Rights Commissioner, spoke to the cross-party group on adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse. That was way back in April 2010. And he talked then about how some parliaments had passed laws to ensure an apology could be given. And I'm heartened that he remains supportive of the bill and of the view that a generic apology in the context of historic child abuse should not be admissible, and that an apology law is one important element among a range of remedies and improved access to justice to which survivors are entitled. A meaningful apology includes recognition of what has gone wrong and an assurance that the circumstances will be reviewed, and in the case of historic in-care survivors, that the state puts in place arrangements to ensure the abuse is not repeated. With this in mind, I sought to give the opportunity for the widest possible disclosure so historic abuse victims and others would have both the acknowledgement of the wrong done or bad outcome and a full explanation which they sought. The application of the bill is not restricted but is wide-ranging, and it applies to civil proceedings in the public, private, third and voluntary sectors. I arrived at the definition of an apology which contains protection for statements of fact and fault after much deliberation. Evidence to the committee has focused on whether the effect of the bill could be in certain circumstances to prevent an individual securing compensation, in particular where a statement of fact within an apology might be the only evidence available. I'm aware that there is a balance to be struck to ensure there are no unintended consequences of injustice to pursuers. This has been a consistent concern of the Minister, and I thank him for his willingness to engage and to remain open-minded about the bill, which he supports in principle. Having listened carefully to what witnesses and Minister have to say, I am persuaded that the wording at Section 3B on statements of fact could be omitted from the bill. Stage 1 has provided the opportunity for the robust testing of the bill's provisions. There is a fear that an admission of fault can, in some circumstances, lead to litigation. Section 3A addresses that problem by removing the legal disincentives. However, I recognise that there may be risks in providing such protections. I also recognise here that the Minister is not currently persuaded that the harm prevented outweighs the potential risk of harm caused. I should be interested to hear the committee's views. At the end of the day, this comes down to a policy decision, and it may well be I have to accept that the Minister remains of the view that inclusion of fault may be a step too far. The effect of the omissions, if they are to be enacted, of 3A fault and certainly fact, bring the bill closer to the terms of Section 2 of the Compensation Act, which I believe the Minister has confirmed he would be content with. However, Section 2 is a single provision within a broader act, and it does not contain a definition of an apology. My bill would still contain a definition and the ability for the apologiser to indicate that a lessons learned exercise would be carried out, which is what the pursuer generally seeks. The indication of a possible review would be protected and may help give the apologiser confidence and encouragement to make the apology in the first place. Finally, Convener, I confirm that I am keen to continue to engage in further dialogue with the Minister on matters of detail on the bill, to which the Minister referred during his evidence session last week, and to consider amendments at Stage 2 where there is a case to be made for further exemptions. Thank you.
Thank you, Margaret, for your statement, which was very helpful in clarifying your views and how it might go forward. Can I invite members to ask questions? Alison and Roddy.
Good morning, Ms. Mitchell. When we had our round table, there were a number of representatives from the BMA and from the nursing professions who expressed some concern about the impact that agreeing an apology might have on their professional body's kind of code of conduct. And I wonder if you've an opportunity to discuss that with either the GMC or indeed with the Nursing and Midwifery Council.
Yes, thank you for that. Yes, there were concerns expressed during the evidence session. I have been in contact with the GMC. I think, in fact, the committee have had correspondence from the GMC this morning, which I think is helpful in clarifying the position. It's entirely proper the GMC under Regulation 55 of the Good Medical Practice, which became effective in 22nd of April 2015, expects its registrants to apologise and to offer an explanation. If they fail to do so, there is at least the possibility the regulator would investigate this as a conduct matter. That dovetails with the duty of candour already in operation in England and Wales. However, I think what was happening at the evidence session was that those giving evidence were conflating the statutory protection of an apology and the statutory duty to provide an apology. The draft legislation does not require the professionals to apologise and will not place them in any greater peril from regulatory sanction than they would face already. And I think the letter from the GMC very helpfully clarifies that point and hopefully gives the medical professionals who raised this point some reassurance.
That's helpful. If I might, you mentioned the duty of candour. The Minister has argued that the scope of your bill could undermine the duty of candour, and he, I think, has been suggesting that that duty should be excluded from the scope of your bill. Do you have a view on that, Ms Mitchell?
Yes, my fear would be that if it was admissible, then that would deter medical professionals and doctors from giving an apology in the first place. Charlie Irvin quotes from some academics who said most experts continue to view the fear of liability as the primary barrier to the development of effective and wide-sweeping patient safety initiatives in hospital. And I think if it's then admissible, despite all the protections around it, then that could possibly deter them from giving an apology. Now, having said that, it's going to be up to the government to decide its policy on this, and certainly under the provisions of the Act, it already has the duty or the powers, and I'll just read you, it's 2D, to vary and include other exceptions. Regulations, the Scottish Minister may by regulation modify the list of exceptions in subsection 1. Alternatively, this could be an amendment brought forward at stage 2.
Thank you, Convener. Roderick?
Thank you, Convener. I think perhaps I should refer to my register of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates, but can I refer you to the evidence of Mr. Stevenson of the Faculty of Advocates on the 9th of June, where he talked about the fact that, in the faculty's view, the bill, if enacted, would take away from people rights which they currently have, and therefore, from the point of view of access to justice, it might actually limit access to justice. Would you like to comment on this question of taking away rights from people?
Perhaps you'd like to expand on that, Mr. Campbell, can I say, just to answer the question more generally, in effect, really what the bill is doing is clarifying the current law and just putting it in statute, which I think is helpful. But if you'd like to expand on...
At the present time, an admission of liability can be used in evidence, especially an admission against interest, as I think Ronnie Conway, the Association of Professional of Personal Injury Lawyers, made the same point. Whereas under the terms of your bill, any such admission would not be admissible. So there would be, therefore, a limitation on the current position, so it's not a reinforcement of the current position.
I think what you've just said explains why we need the apology bill and to tease out exactly what is an admission of liability. Admission of liability certainly would not be protected, but the terms of the bill, admission of regret, of sorrow, the taking of responsibility, the offer of redress to review into the circumstances are all protected. And we're debating, what we're looking at further, is whether we can go and admit fault as well, given that an admission of fault is not an admission of liability. In fact, there's very useful case law on this particular point, and I think the leading case is Hunter versus Hanley, 1955, which gives a three test for establishing liability. There must be usual normal practice, this practice mustn't have been adopted, and the course of practice adopted must be such that no one acting with ordinary care would have taken that. And I think the Law Society go a little bit further and explain the duty or how negligence is proved, which is prove the duty of care has been breached and that there has been loss or injury caused by that. Now, that's a world away from saying I'm sorry, I made a mistake, or are saying that was my fault. Very often people do that when it clearly isn't their fault. I can give a personal example of this. On the N8 motorway, I was stationary. I had this sensation, my car was moving forward. It went into the car in front. I got out the car and said, I'm really sorry about that. You know, I've no idea what happened. That was my fault. You know, here's my card. You know, there's no damage done. But, you know, there it is if we need to pursue it further. But it just so happened that way down the line when I went to East Kilbride, parked at the public library, someone got out and said, I saw what happened on the motorway there, that guy running into you. If you need a witness, let me know. And I got out, I said, sorry, I said it's my fault. It patently wasn't my fault. And I think that is the... That's the difficulty. The fact that I've now excluded statements of fact means the facts can be looked at, but the way case law is going just now, it's accepted that admission of fault is not the same as an admission of liability.
Could I just comment? Obviously, I'm not supposed to be giving evidence, but would you agree that the test in Hunter and in Hanley is about the test for professional negligence, for want of a better word, whether there's a failure to exercise reasonable care and skill? That's not the same thing in a motor accident, for example, where things are perhaps slightly more clear-cut. So it's clearly established that in a professional negligence case, saying you're sorry is not the same thing as saying that you have failed to exercise the degree of care and skill to be expected of a reasonably competent professional. So I think we might be conflating the two. But... I'm not giving evidence, so I should be careful with that. Mm-hmm. But the faculty went on to say in their evidence that if in their view, the bill would disadvantage certain people, where is the balancing advantage? And how confident can we be that there would be a benefit from depriving people of the rights they currently have? And they've looked at the empirical evidence around the world, and they can't actually seem to find anywhere that seems to be good evidence that... laws such as this actually work. So where is the empirical evidence to support this legislation?
Yeah, Roger Campbell's absolutely right. It is difficult to establish hard facts about how this legislation works. There are various apologies laws, and what we can say is that in United States, in Australia and in Canada, these laws have been in place for 10, maybe 12 years and have not been altered and have not been found to be causing any problems. In fact, I can go further and give you the comment from Chris Wheeler, Deputy Ombudsman of New South Wales, who's commented that for several years, apology legislation has been regularly reviewed in terms of case law across Australia and Canada, in particular to see if there have been any unintended consequences and search for media stories that might point to a downside. No evidence appears to have been found that the statutory protection for apologies has had any negative results. So I suppose I'm turning it around, Ms. Campbell, and saying if there may not be a hard and fast in empirical evidence, then these laws have been in place for many years now and do seem to be unproblematic. And this research has been carried out in New South Wales, and again, no negative results found. So I hope that would give the committee some comfort.
Thank you.
Thanks, John.
Give you an anonymous Mitchell. Yeah, I'm inherently sympathetic to this approach. You used a couple of terms in your opening remarks, and that was about an entrenched culture and a perception of increased litigation. And I'm wondering the extent to which the position of, for instance, insurance companies relates to that, where they will normally exclude cover if you've admitted liability. That's a factor that will go to create that culture. And what will the implications for your proposed legislation be on that, please?
Yeah, Right. I'm very encouraged that the Association of British Insurers have chosen not to comment on the bill, which indicates that they're broadly content with the...
Is that a reasonable assumption?
Having spoken with the Association of British Insurers over a period of time, because I have to admit that I first came into the Bills team waving the British Columbia one-page bill in front of them about 3 years ago, saying, well, this shouldn't take too long, it's relatively straightforward. So there has been a lot of in-depth study and analysis to get to the point where we're at. And therefore, I can assure Mr. Finley, I'm very encouraged with the fact that they've chosen not to comment. But more than that, we know that if fault and fact is taken out, they are perfectly happy with what's remained, which seems to be the essence of the Section 2 of the Compensation Act, and it's clear that wouldn't void any contracts. So, yes, I'm encouraged that the position we're in just now would not cause any problems with the insurance companies.
And in the event of the legislation being passed as is, then how will you envisage the promotion of the legislation? Because that's how you'd ultimately be changing culture longer term.
Yeah. I think the fact that you have an apology bill in the first place, it goes a long way for people to have confidence to say, right, apologies, worried about it. We know staff are worried about it, despite all the training, despite all the insurances. Knowing that the law and legal certainty and the various how evidence plays is all contained in the apology bill, I think, would be helpful. But I do envisage under guidelines a campaign of explaining more and highlighting more and doing having other measures that would help the promotion of apologies and raise awareness of it and lead to better practice and better outcomes.
And finally, if I may, I may have missed this. The position of the Scottish Children's Reporter Administration about the exclusion. Do you have a comment on that, please?
Yes, I have met with them. It would depend really on the final format of the bill, whether we include fault or not at the end of the day. If fault isn't included, it looks as though it would be unnecessary. It wouldn't apply. They wouldn't need the exception. If fault is included, then I'm sympathetic to looking at that as an exception, because I understand there it's to establish the main facts that they're looking at, rather than to look at a legal proceeding as such. So I'd be sympathetic to that being an inclusion.
Okay, thank you very much.
It's a supplementary on this. Yes,
on the question of insurance. Would you agree it might actually be in the commercial interest of insurers for this legislation to take place, because it potentially will restrict the rights of pursuers or plaintiffs to bring cases where otherwise they'd be able to found on admission or apology, whatever you care to say. Given the terms of this legislation, that would be exclusively, it would not be possible to refer to that in subsequent proceedings, and that would be generally to the advantage of a defendant insurer. Would you agree with that?
Perhaps I could explain or address that question by saying just now, and I think you gave a perfect example when you said admissions of liability, which of course are admissible, confusing this idea of admissions of fault and regret, etc. All that is covered in evidence just now, and if pursuers are then encouraged to go forward by legal representatives, solicitors, philosophy of advocates, personal insurance lawyers, when they have given an apology in these terms, then they're going to be disappointed at the end of the day. They're going to incur legal costs, which they shouldn't have incurred and will inevitably be there despite loser pays, the loser pays rule. So at the end of the day, then I think it could work very well to the benefit of those pursuing a claim, because the giving of an apology under these terms and the inadmissibility of it doesn't stop them pursuing compensation if they're not satisfied that that's sufficient redress and if they feel there is a case to answer. The only difference would be they're likely to keep more of the compensation payment and not pay out in unintended costs to legal representatives.
Okay,
Thank you.
Chris?
Supplementary on that question, thanks very much, Convener. Regarding the financial and insurance professional regulations, you don't think there'll be a conflict because they are reserved matters?
Yes, I can. Can I give Christian Allard some reassurance on that very point, that this was looked at in the memorandum, was it? I've got it here. But according to the parliamentary rules, the question of it being a reserved matter was looked at, and the bill was competent. Now, does that answer your question, or was there...
I will find it difficult because we know how much reservation we have to the introduction of such a bill. So in the implementation could find a lot of difficulties if it's not recognised, if the profession doesn't recognise that this Parliament's got, if it's reserved, it could end up being debated in another Parliament than this one.
I think maybe we're confusing two things here. The legislation is ruled to be competent under the Scotland Act in that it clarifies the law. It doesn't seek to change insurance, which, as you rightly say, policy is reserved. I think you may be referring to maybe a tribunal which might have a reserved aspect and some devolved aspect, in which case these are issues of details that I think could successfully be teased out at stage two. And I go back to the fact that under Section 2D, ministers have the right to make exemptions or under the bill as we go along.
And always, and my main question is this: it seems to be very complicated, and there seems to be a lot of objection to it. Minor, some could say minor, but my biggest problem is what you said earlier on, when you were asked about empirical evidence that such legislation is working in a way in the world, your answer was there were no evidence to the contrary, but in fact that such a legislation was introduced and there were no negative effect to it. I do have an objection to this, introducing the law which have no positive effect. Which only have no negative effect, to my mind, is a law to many. So it's very difficult to understand what difference this law will make if there is no evidence. And we worked very hard in this committee to try to find evidence that such legislation will work, but we didn't find any.
Well, I think there's a lot of things needing to be broken up there. The first part of your question, there's no hard facts and empirical evidence. There is, I suppose you could say, in some of the US, that's the nearest that we get it, the United States, some evidence that after apology has been granted then, or passed then, legislation has been passed then, cases went up in the short term, and then litigation seemed to fall away. But as I said at the beginning, this is not a bill to address any perceived increase in litigation. It's to address the fear of litigation, which is unfounded. And I think as an MSP, I would be surprised if you, Mr. Allard, and everyone else here hadn't been in a situation where someone comes to you and says, look, such and such an event happened. All I want is acknowledgement of this, an apology, and to make sure, above all, that it doesn't happen to anyone else. Now, this gives the legal certainty to the person from whom the apology is sought to give that apology and to give that explanation and to try and make sure it doesn't happen to anyone else. And I think the benefits from that are absolutely huge. It brings closure. For years and years, people can hang on to an incident and keep going back and over it because they never, ever got an apology. In fact, that's why some apology was law introduced in Massachusetts in the very first place, way back in 1986. A senator's daughter was killed in an accident. An apology was never given. And that, I think we underestimate just the power of an apology to make a difference. So perhaps I could suggest that if you looked at your glass being half full rather than half empty. That would be a good way to look at the legislation.
It's very difficult to find an evidence, and we tried very much, which is a question. But when you talked about entrenched culture to never apologise, it does exist, but it is that entrenched when, in fact, we see that from the Nursing and Midwife Council and General Medical Council, a lot of things happening to make sure that people will apologise more and more, professionals will apologise more and more. So it's not if nothing is happening, a lot of things are happening. And don't you think that legislation will be better introduced, like if it was in England, incorporated in another bill, and like the Scottish Government is thinking about doing with the duty of candour, having it incorporated seems to be a lot more receptive from professionals, from professional bodies, who seems to prefer it in England, like it has been introduced, or here in Scotland, like with the bill is going to introduce it. Don't you think it would be a preferred way?
No, I think it's a misunderstanding in what you say. It's not the fact it's incorporated in another bill that, you know, seems to have found favour. It was the terms of the Compensation Act, you know, sorrow, regret, even the taking of responsibility and looking at redress were all considered to be protected in an apology, and my bill is therefore saying should be inadmissible. So I think there is huge value in just clarifying what is already the law and giving real legal certainty within the apology bill, so that people can have the confidence to apologise. And I think that's the value of putting on and establishing an apology bill on the statute book, where people can have that confidence. They can look to the apology legislation, and it will hopefully result in this fear being taken away and people being much more encouraged to give an apology. And I think there is real value in having standalone legislation to promote that.
We don't have it down south. It's not standalone legislation on that particular issue. And we would have that type of legislation incorporated with the duty of candour in Scotland. So there is a question, is you would maybe think about delaying your bill and see how he would the duty of candour, the introduction of duty of candour will change the system. Would you not thinking about delaying your bill to see how it will be, how the legislation will be changed?
I feel that, you know, I'm really genuinely puzzled about, you know, why we should be putting all our eggs in one basket to look at medical provision under a duty of candour and not considering the hugely widely application of this bill. If you look at the legal service at the Public Service Ombudsman, who's always been so supportive of the legislation, because he knows the longer it takes to give an effective an apology to stop giving the non-apologies, like, I'm sorry if you felt, to really give an effective apology and to deal with the situation the complainant has talked at, the more the prices and the cost goes up and the more unsatisfactory it is for the person who's seeking that apology. In the private sphere, I could give lots of examples of places where an effective apology just calms everything down and lets people get on with resolving the issue that needs to be looked at, and I think that's a real value on it. So to me, then, the duty of candour can be looked at stage two. The government can choose to make an exception. That can go on in its own right. It's new legislation. I think in England and Wales, part of it has still to be enacted. The main part was introduced in 2014. So we're a long way to looking at how effective that is and how it's going to play out. So I see no reason or no logic in not going forward with this bill because of the duty of candour.
And last question, you don't see any logic to maybe exclude the medical profession from your bill?
Well, I think we look at the circumstances. GMC have already been supportive of the apology being given and being inadmissible in civil proceedings. That came in this morning. I think the detail of how it plays out could be looked at stage two, but we do have the general comfort that it isn't going to affect, no one's telling the medical procession that they must apologise as a result of this bill. But there are some real guidelines, I think, and provisions that would give the medical profession comfort. And I think it's good this morning we've established and the GMC have confirmed that it wouldn't interfere with their guidelines or have any effect on the guidelines and the giving of the apologies that they've laid down.
Thank you.
Gil?
Thank you so much. Margaret, the Minister is suggesting that public inquiries, arbitrations and tribunals should be excluded from the bill. Would you like to make comment on that?
Yes, there again, I'm quite relaxed and prepared to look at this at stage two. If the case is made that there should be an exception, then clearly the committee will decide that at stage two. But I realise that it may not be a definitive list. Depends again on the final provisions of the bill. It might not be necessary to do that if the bill drops fault and we're left with the expression of regret and just offered to redress. But in general, answer to your questions, I'm perfectly happy to look at these as exceptions as the bill progresses.
I noted the answer that you gave to John Finney in relation to the Scottish Children's Reporters Administration. And if you were looking at to remove that from the bill, it was sympathetic.
Yeah.
Notes, words that you gave us there. If you were doing that, wouldn't that, you know, effectively weaken the effect of what you're trying to achieve here?
Well,
by making all these exclusions.
I think, you know, each of the cases must be made. The case must be made for quite robustly by teasing out why you would want an exception, mostly it's come about with tribunals, arbitration. All of these have to be looked at in detail. But the general principle of the bill is to provide this legal certainty about being able to say sorry and express regret and take responsibility. And that certainly isn't weakened, if anything. That provides much more assurance to people, especially the undertaking to look into the circumstances and see if any lessons can be learned. So, again, the detail is going to be up to a policy decision at the end of the day, but the wider principles of the bill and the provisions to deliver these wider principles, I think, are ones that are worthy of going ahead, regardless of the exceptions which may, at the end of the day, be incorporated in the bill.
Yes, excellent.
Jane?
I was wondering whether you've got any thoughts or comments on how the bill will interact with pre-action protocols?
My feeling is there should be nothing in the bill that interferes with legal proceedings as they are, and therefore if legal proceedings are already under will, the bill would not be come into effect. So, if apologies are already used in media proceedings and they are underway, then of course it would be the same law applying. So my bill would only come into effect if there had been no legal proceedings underway and it was an apology given without legal proceedings being looked at all.
And do you think how it's drafted at the moment, that covers that? Do you think that's clear at the moment in how it's drafted? Or will it
if it's not clear, then I think there's an opportunity to make it clearer as the bill progresses.
OK, and just one other thing, just to clarify for me. I heard you say in your statement that you're content to take out the reference to fact. I'm not clear on what you said about fault. Are you still considering that? Are you still talking to people about that?
Yes, it's clear that at the moment the minister feels that the possible risk of harm doesn't balance with the possible benefits of the bill. Now, that's to be teased out. I mean, I think already we've heard admissions of liability being conflated with statements of fact, and there are various hurdles to go through before before fault would be a statement of liability. But at the end of the day, I fully realise that this isn't a hard and fast black or white decision. It's going to be a policy decision, and people will know from their own feelings, from their own assessment, just which side of the balance that the inclusion of fault might fall. And what I'm saying is, if it's the government's decision, having looked at fault again and what would be the consequences of that, that it still feels the balance is more against a pursuer, then I'm happy to accept that, and fault would therefore be excluded. But I hope we can have that debate, and it is looked at thoroughly, because it can make such a difference, really, to people if people are able to say, sorry, I made a mistake, whether you did or not, as my example kind of proved. I think that just encourages a more full and balanced apology.
Thank you. Thanks.
Any other questions?
We heard obviously from the government, but we also heard from the Forum of Insurance Lawyers in respect of the legislation, Section 2 of the Compensation Act 2006 in England, that certainly Mr. Watson, the insurance lawyers, said that straightforward legislation such as that made it clear that an act of apology itself did not amount to an admission of liability would have great merit, which I think is a view also shared by the government. Why would you like to just recap why you think following the example in England would be inappropriate?
Sorry, I didn't hear the end of what you said.
Why don't we just run with something similar to Section 2 of the Compensation Act in England?
Yes, to probably add to the quote and certainly the submission for the Forum of Insurance of Lawyers, they did say, yes, they'd be happy with the kind of Section 2 type provision, but also they were happy with the provisions of the bill. If we didn't go that way, then they were content with the provisions of the bill, all of them to be included. However, your main point is really what's the added value? And the added value is the Compensation Act doesn't give a definition of an apology. Now, this is not prescriptive. It just shows what can be included in an apology and what helps to be included in an apology. That's laid out in statute. And again, I go back to sorrow, regret, the taking of responsibility, the acknowledgement the thing has happened in the first place is a pretty important thing for those seeking an apology, and certainly to bring closure, the indication, as we've got in 3C, that you can look at the circumstances with a view to seeing if any lessons can be learned, I think is also huge, none of which is really in the Compensation Act. Therefore, I think there is certainly huge added value in going beyond that. And it changes the law too in ensuring that the apology, which has no legal effect and isn't taken in evidence, is inadmissible. So it is going a little bit further, and I think that all helps and encourages the principle and intent of the bill, which is to encourage apologies.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commander. I just go back to the General Medical Council memorandum. I didn't find anything itself who said that it was supporting the bill.
The letter that's come through?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. They have today sent a statement through which says, which is helpful. which said we would support an apology being inadmissible in minimissible of legal liability in civil proceedings. They go on to talk about other, but not inadmissible in other circumstances, fitness to practice, etc. These are other details which I can share with the committee and which again could be teased out at stage two. But I think that that certainly suggests that they support the inadmissibility of legal liability in civil proceedings, which is what the bill does.
Right, but we are not directly saying that we're supporting the bill as such.
Well...
But, no, it's all right. That's fine.
Okay.
That's what I wanted to know. Thank you. Thank you. Go on.
Could I just ask a wee technical point then, just at the end? You specifically exempt inquiries under the Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths Inquiry Scotland Act 1976, but as you know, the Inquiries into Fatal Accidents and Sudden Deaths, etc. bill actually repeals that act. Might it be better? I just wondered whether there would be merit in having all the exemptions defined by Scottish ministers in the first place.
Well, that's certainly a stage two type amendment, which I think may have some merit in working and is worthy of consideration at that point. It's more on the detail, but important detail.
Thanks. Thanks, Mark and Maiden Still, Neil Ross, for attending the committee. And just suspend for a couple of minutes to let Margaret come back to her normal position in the committee. Thank you. We now move on to item 6, EU issues. Paper 5 invites the committee to note correspondence from the European and External Relations Committee in relation to its work on migration and from the Minister on migration and its EU e-justice work. I'm going to invite Roderick Campbell as our EU reporter to say anything about the correspondence received once he can find it.
2 minutes. I don't really think I have much to add beyond what's already in the paper, to be honest, unless anyone's got any specific questions.
Invite any other members to make comments on those? John?
Simply to say, I mean, it's a humanitarian disaster that's referred to in here with issues in the Mediterranean, and I think there's a very positive plan there, and I certainly commend the Scottish Government's approach. It is one of a humanitarian and not punitive, and I think that's what I would like to see as lender support too.
Indeed.
I was particularly encouraged by the Scottish Government giving the understanding of European cooperation, saying it's cooperation which is important, not isolation, is key in that particular matter. And I'm really much encouraged with the response of the Scottish Government.
Any further comment?
Convener, to see 4 positive steps for taking things forward. It's good to see here's what can be done. That's very refreshing.
Absolutely.
When sometimes you spend time in here being bamboozled, it was helpful to say that's what we're going to do.
Excellent. So members are content to note the correspondence and return to the issue after the summer recess when we are likely to have received another update from the Minister. Excellent. Item 7, I have to do that beforehand. Right. We agreed to at item 1 to move into private session for the final item, item 7, the draft report into the inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden deaths, etc. Scotland Bill. So if we can do so. Thank you very much.